really hard this week and had a lot of fun getting to know each other and each other's play, and we're pretty excited for what the future holds. I'd like to introduce the group. We have Dr. Eric Millard. We got Dr. Lance Witte, Dr. Kevin Whalen, Dr. Zach Bowie, and Dr. Chris Scanlon. My name is Jesse Cook. Thanks for coming out. We're really excited to share this program with you. That first piece was Forever Sky by Florida-based composer Joshua Hobbs. It depicts the vastness and glory of outer space. The title is derived from a poem entitled Outer Space, written by Pulitzer Prize winner William Matthews. And now I'd like to pass the baton over to my colleague, Scanlon.
Good evening. It's great to be with you. The second piece we'll play in our program is by Oscar Bim, the Brass Sextet, Opus Number 30, originally written in 1906 and then published in 1911. He was a trumpet player, originally born in Germany, studied in Leipzig, and then lived in St. Petersburg, playing in the Mariinsky Theater for 24 years there. He's written a lot of important trumpet works, including the Great Trumpet Concerto. The original sextet was for three trumpets. It's usually played with a horn, a trombone, and a bass trombone or a tuba. This evening, we're going to present it to you with six trumpets and the solo part on the small E-flat trumpet. It follows a sonata form. There's a beautiful chorale at the beginning and some lyrical playing as well as some technical writing. There's a couple allusions to some compositional things from Mendelssohn as well. And our arrangement is by Adam Gautier. Hope you enjoy the thing. Thank you.
So the next piece on the program is Neon Fanfares by Dr. Elaine Ross. Dr. Ross serves on faculty at Morgan State University and is an active and sought-after composer and collaborative pianist. Neon Fanfare was commissioned in 2009 by Central Washington University Trumpet Club for performance at the National Trumpet Competition in Washington, D.C. The 5.5 minute work is scored for 6 equally important trumpet parts. Although essentially through composed, the work has a slow introductory section followed by a faster, more intense rhythmic section. This piece features subtle close harmonies that provide coloristic effects, fanfare passages throughout, and a dance-like theme in 7/8 providing rhythmic intensity with lyrical quality. Hope you enjoy.
Thank you.
Thank you. right-hand man, Billy Strayhorn, in 1933. This next piece is a little bit later. As I said, he was active through his entire life. This is a chart that was written by Ellington, and this is lead alto player Johnny Hodges in 1944, and made famous in 1945, and there's a few really important recordings of it. My favorite recording of this tune, which I guess I should mention to you, is called I'm Beginning to See the Light. It was probably first made famous by the one and only Ella Fitzgerald, which I should mention is my favorite musician of all time, no matter the instrument. I think she's the greatest jazz musician that ever lived. It wasn't a composer necessarily. But her audition had competition. And you'll all be pleased to know that Harry James was that competition. He actually released a recording of it in 1945 that challenged Ella's version on the charts. And of course, Duke had to get in on the fun because he started the whole thing, and he wrote another version with another vocalist that was also came out in 1945, the end of the Second World War. So pretty good time in America. This is going to feature the whole gang, but especially my man Jesse Cook on the lead part over here. This is Duke Ellington, Johnny Hodges. I'm beginning to see the light.
Thank you. state of Ohio on the front of it, but it says Idaho in the middle of it. Has anybody ever confused Ohio with Idaho? Probably not, but we get confused for Ohio or Iowa all the time. It's good to be here in Ohio. It's my first time actually in this state, so the hospitality has been fantastic. This next piece that we're about to perform is called Compressionism, kind of a fun play on the word Impressionism, and it's by a composer named Mike D'Ambrosio. It was composed, premiered back in 2012, commissioned by Eric Swisher for the International Trumpet Guild for the Festival of Trumpets performance when that conference was held down in Columbus, Columbus State University in Georgia that summer. Now, the reason it has this name, Compressionism, is because at the beginning you're going to hear this lyrical solo, and then there's a four-part texture kind of just hovering underneath it, pushing this kind of vague chord progression forward. But you'll hear the top two voices of that four-voice texture start to descend chromatically, and the bottom two voices start to ascend chromatically. So they're coming in on each other. And as this four-voice texture gets passed around and kind of furthered throughout the piece, it becomes shorter. Speed picks up, but that kind of mentality, like crunching everything in, continues all the way throughout. So everything is compressing both harmonically and rhythmically. So it's a pretty fun piece. And I asked the guys, a couple of the guys earlier today, any great adjective that you would have to describe compressionism? And the only one that they came up with was cool. But I think that works. You're gonna hear some tonality that might remind you of some more impressionistic sounds. So I hope you enjoy Compressionism by Mike D'Ambrosio.
Thank you.
sort of for signaling and to play in courts and everything. However, there's really kind of a big gap in repertoire. We don't get a lot of pieces written for trumpet ensemble until really the last 20, 30 years especially. And a lot of that has come from the ideas spurred on by the International Trumpet Guild and especially the National Trumpet Competition. So when the National Trumpet Competition started in 1991, they started an ensemble division. And this was the first time the trumpet ensembles really had a chance to kind of compete and develop repertoire and kind of build the whole genre of what we're doing. And so fast forward about 15 years from that, in the mid-2000s, a composer by the name of Eric Morales, who was a trumpet student at Grand Valley State University, started writing pieces for their trumpet ensemble to compete at the National Trumpet Competition. And being a trumpet player himself, Morales was really great at writing idiomatic, kind of flashy and fun works for the trumpet and the trumpet ensemble as a whole that would really showcase what the ensemble could do that would be really competitive. And so that kind of started a tradition, and the Grand Valley ensembles kept winning NTC over and over with these really fantastic pieces that were catchy and engaging and fun for trumpet ensembles to play. So Morales sort of made a name for himself by doing that. And the one other thing that kind of came with all of this is that, as you can imagine, trumpet is kind of a loud instrument. It can be flashy, it can be showy, and so we get a lot of that sort of persona as trumpet ensembles. This is going to be kind of trumpet band or kind of in your face and loud and exciting the whole time. So Gary Mortensen, the former teacher at Kansas State University, now the chair at Baylor University, decided in 2011 to celebrate the International Trumpet Guild's 30th anniversary. He wanted to commission a trumpet ensemble work for the entire organization, for all the members to have for free and to enjoy. So he contacted Eric Morales and specifically asked for something completely different from what he'd been doing traditionally. He said, I want this piece to be for a trumpet choir, not for a trumpet ensemble, really with that kind of vocal quality in mind. So with that, Morales started writing Within Sacred Walls. And it's sort of inspired by kind of Gothic cathedrals, that beautiful big stone spaces and the chants that would have been heard in those spaces. So this is really an opportunity for the trumpet ensemble to showcase just a completely different color, completely different soundscape. So I hope you enjoy this really beautiful interpretation of some trumpet music Within Sacred Walls by Eric Morales.
Thank you.
absolute staple in the trumpet ensemble repertoire, written by yet another trumpet player, Kevin McKee. He's written quite a number of really wonderful works for both trumpet ensemble, trumpet solo, trumpet duo, chamber ensembles. And he's really into this idea of programmatic music, so music that kind of depicts a scene or depicts an emotion or something that you kind of almost see clearly. Really inspired by composers of movie music like John Williams, James Horner, all those kind of greats in that business. He wanted to kind of capture the same essence in his own compositions. And so the next piece, Dürrenhorn Passage, does just that. So Dürrenhorn is a mountain in the south of Switzerland, not too far from the Matterhorn. So you can just imagine these sweeping epic landscapes, sublime mountain scenery, glaciers, rocky faces and cliffs. And his idea with this whole piece is that you're just sort of soaring like a bird or a plane through this mountain scene, through these mountain passes, and really enjoying that landscape. Before we close, I do want to say a couple thank yous. Thank you so much to Dr. Lance Witte, the whole put a tremendous amount of work into organizing everything for this recital in terms of all the rehearsals, the concert itself, the screening, everything. Thank you to everyone facilitating this here this evening. Thanks to the entire conservatory here at Capital University. It has been an absolute treat to be here this week, an absolute treat to get to perform in your wonderful venues. Thank you to everyone tuning in online, and hopefully we'll get to hear from you soon and we'll have more concerts. So this is Dürrenhorn.